screen now. Yes.
You will control that, Kaushik. You will put us off, or shall we do it?
No, ma'am. Everyone will be on only, so it will be going on like that. It's on live now. We can start. Hello, everyone. A very good evening to all of you. Before starting our discussion, I request all of the participants to mute your microphones and turn off your video. You can raise your hand, unmute yourself, and ask questions, if any, as the discussion proceeds. Before introducing all the panelists, I would like to say a few words about our topic chosen for today's panel discussion. Every year, Indian government introduces lot of new schemes regarding women empowerment, and main focus of these schemes always lies in improving number of women students and employees in all the sectors. India has always seen rise in women students in all sectors from 5% at the time of independence to 40% now approximately in the past, and it is still rising. Based on an article which appeared in the Wire, ratio of women pursuing science and its allied subjects as major is about 35% to 40%, which is high compared to other developed countries, which ranges from only 15% to 25%. But a similar article in the same Wire states ratio of all who are actually practicing science is less than 15 in India, when compared to other European countries, which is always above than 28%. Now, let's discuss the real scenario today from our four inspiring researchers who are from different backgrounds. And as Oprah Winfrey quotes, follow your own passion that will lead your own purpose. And our panelists are best example for it. I would like to take the privilege to introduce them to you. Starting with Dr. Radha. She is an emeritus scientist in CCMB whose interest is in studying molecular mechanism involved in sulfate regulation and maintenance of homeostasis. She has been practicing science for nearly 40 years, balancing both personal and professional life. And this has been definitely possible because of her determination towards science. She is a wonderful cell biology teacher and has inspired many students to take up research. She believes that being a scientist is not only doing experiments and generating new knowledge, but a way of life. We welcome you, Radha.
Then
Dr. Anuradha Reddy. She is a scientist at Laboratory for Conservation of Endangered Species, who mainly focuses on tiger conservation through genetic and genomic analysis. Her love towards animals from her childhood turned as passion and made her to choose veterinary science, followed by animal conservation. Unlike most, she opted for wildlife research with lot of passion, leaving her 9-to-5 secured job from a top biotech company. I would say that she is living an adventurous life with which many of us crave for. We welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Then Dr. Megha Kumar. Dr. Megha is a DST Inspire faculty at CSIR CCMB. Her research interest lies in understanding cell division dynamics during embryonic development. Being a mother to a toddler has not become a hurdle in running a research lab, doing experiments, and mentoring students. Her dedication towards science drives her to manage her research work and personal life with a very perfect balance. We welcome you, Dr. Megha.
Thank you.
And last, but not the least, Dr. Sonal Nagarkar Jaiswal. She is a senior scientist and DBT Wellcome Trust Fellow in CCMB who works in neural stem cell, self-renewal and differentiation using Drosophila as a model system. She played a very important role in developing several tools which helps in differentiating the normal and mutant form of a protein in the same fly. And I would say that it is heavily cited in the field now. Apart from being an enthusiastic neurobiologist, Dr. Sonal is also a passionate runner and an ardent reader. She strongly believes that women should always take a stand for themselves. I guess now you will get the feel that why we chose these four in this Women in Science panel discussion. With this introduction, I request the panelists to share their opinion about the topic Women in Science. We can start with Dr. Radha.
Good evening, all of you who are listening to this debate and discussion. let me tell you, I probably belong to a little older generation and started my higher education and career at a time when very few women had the liberty to get into programs like PhD and becoming scientists. In my case, to be frank, it was just because of a will to do something and a conviction that it is possible to do it. Though the atmosphere at that time, either in the family or in the public, was very, very antagonistic, and the swimming was actually against the tide. But it never actually impinged on my thoughts, and I had blinkers and just went ahead with the task at hand. So I think it's about choosing a career in science was more to do with a conviction, and because it was just my heart and soul to be on a discovery path. So it was more the will and the intent, and it became possible because I made a purposeful choice to channelize my thoughts and put blinkers and compartmentalize what is professional and what is personal. To begin with, I never thought they were mutually exclusive. And that's one point I would want to convey to all the younger people who are on this fork of trying to think of whether being a scientist will have an impact on their personal lives and whether it is possible to do both. So the other point that helps in this kind of a career is how you manage your time and plan your tasks minutely. So every minute of the day almost is like a very precious moment, and you make full utilization of that moment. And take it from me that if it feels that when you have a full-fledged profession, taking care of household jobs, whether it's cooking or serving elders or taking care of babies, is actually not a burden. It helps you in your professional career by providing a balance to do something different while enabling to refresh your thoughts. And it's not that your scientific thoughts will be impeded because you're not spending enough time at your office desk or on the bench as a scientist, because you can do your thinking whether you're bathing or cooking or doing anything else. So these are certainly not mutually exclusive. And I will pass on the points to other people. Before I end, I would like to say one thing. While we think that these are not mutually exclusive, there's something very important to keep in mind, that your work and your profession can wait a little, but your biological age cannot. So keep that in mind.
That was very wonderful, Dr. Radha. Now we would like to hear from Dr. Sonal. Dr. Sonal,
your mic is muted.
Okay. So, yes, we all start with passion and we want to do things. So if you look at PhD students, as you said, in the start, there's so many PhD students who are like girls. And then we think about the next step, postdocs, and then we go to the next step, faculty. But we see the number goes, it's like a pyramid. So what happens in between these things? All the girls, they get married and they have family, then they think about, family, or we should continue in career or family. So what I think and what helped me here is for sure the support from my family, especially my husband, because we are both in science And I would say, so it started from my dad, and then my husband helped me, and all the way, you know, till now, I have good support. So that's why I think, that's why I say I'm here. But when we think about these things, like, as we say, the system is leaky. Students, they come with passion, you know, all the students, young students we see, and then 10 out of like 40 decide to do a postdoc. 3 out of, you know, these 40 finally go for a faculty position. And then maybe they join. And then 1 out of, you know, these 40 eventually becomes a faculty. Because they like this support system from family. And if not family, then their workplace. So I would say for me, it was always family. And of course, you know, my workplace where I got support. So, yes, this is what I think. Megha? You want to say,
Dr. Megha?
Yeah, I think both of you are quite right. You need family support, otherwise it's very difficult. And it's not that you have to choose. These are not two things to choose from to begin with. Okay, so there is no question of a choice here. These are two different aspects of life that we all want, right? As an individual, as a human. So forget the gender. Be it a male or a female, you would want to have a professional career where you do what you really enjoy professionally doing, and at the same time have a family back home where you can lean on, have your emotional support, your you know, someone to go back home to. So this is not a choice that somebody has to make, right, to begin with.
Yes,
and
yes.
It is tough to manage both, but I think if you put it in your mind that, yes, I can do both, half the battle is won right there, that you can do. And you get support from all spheres, so your professional peers, your family. If you don't have family support, then you get, you know, domestic help, all sorts of options you can explore. And I think your family will also give in the same way. And if you are driven enough to drive your professional career, your family will respond, your children, your parents, your husband, your wife, everybody will respond to it. So it works both ways. And I don't think we should call it a choice to begin with at all. Right? Men are not given this choice. So why should women be any different, right?
That was wonderful, Dr. Megha. So now we are going to Dr. Anuradha Reddy.
Thank you, Kaushik. And thank all the organizers for selecting this panel. And as my colleagues have already explained, so this career choice is challenging, and the path is adventurous. There's a lot of work. There's a lot of challenges in this line of work. So mine has not been different. It has been a long journey from veterinary sciences and then biotechnology, children, wildlife. It's been a long journey. There are 3 points which I would like to put forth here for discussion. And I'm sure the youngsters would learn a lot from this. As others have explained, first thing is be passionate and dream big. And have the guts, or you have to follow up your dream. That is important. You have to have the courage to follow through and accomplish what you have dreamt. And always strive for excellence in whatever you dream. It can be science, it can be anything. You can be an astronaut, you can be a scientist, you can be an athlete. But whatever you select and whatever you aim to go for in your life, do it to the best of your ability. And once you've selected your path, once you've decided what you want to do, then you have to be prepared that this journey is not easy. There are a lot of hurdles, a lot of obstacles, and you have to be prepared mentally, physically, to go through and achieve what you want. And the path is not easy, but every single achievement, small or big, every small achievement will give you happiness because it is your choice. So that is important. That's very important. Be it a boy or a girl, I think that's the main thing, the purpose of life. Your life should have meaning. And for the girls, I think it's very important right from a young age that you build a support system of women around you. okay, these may be older, experienced women. And I think in the urban society, we are losing this touch, that we do not have a support system, neither at home, nor in office, nor in our society. And that's because we are all the time in the race, and we have limited time to do a lot of things in our life. So this support system is very important. It's a sisterhood. You have older women who are more experienced, who'll help you shoulder your problems. And you can be a support system for the younger women. That's important, and that's going to get you through most of the problems in life. Yeah, so that's it. We can discuss this further. Thank you.
Yes, I guess that 3 point need to be there in everyone's mind, whether it is men or women. Yes. So let's go into the discussion. I would like to ask this question to all four of you, because you all four are achievers. So many working women choose family when it comes to choosing between family and work. Since you already told that your family is a very big support for you to be here, but I just wanted to know what gave you the confidence to decide that you can manage both work and family. We can start with Sonal.
Yeah, so as I said, my family, so the confidence that I got, because I had full support from my husband. We have a kid, he shares responsibilities of him and household work with me. So then I was sure that, okay, I can do it. I get enough time to come here and then, you know, also give time to my kid and follow my passions, as you initially told, right? So for me, it was always the confidence because of my family. And now I can say even my students, because, you know, they also help me a lot, because there are times when I have to leave and go. So they can help. They actually help me here in CCMB at my workplace right now. So for me, it was family, and now family at CCMB.
That was so sweet, ma'am. So then we are going to Dr. Megha. What do you think that gave you the confidence?
To begin with, as a child, my own mother, because she's been working since my childhood, and I could see that she could manage both. And then I saw a lot of other women around her, and I see my own colleagues when I was doing masters and bachelors. I saw my teachers, they were all married, they all had children, but they were still teaching us in colleges and they had careers. And I'm very thankful to all those teachers who taught me. Most of them were married, most of them had children. So I've seen women at different phases of my life who've managed both during PhD, postdoc, even now at CCMB. Most of my colleagues are managing both things, right? So when you grow up with many women having both things juggling themselves successfully, and they would have different fortes in their own family and strengths. But I see all my colleagues doing it. So then that's something that I've learned over the years with multiple people, starting with my mother. And yes, I also want to thank my students, because they work around the flexibility, which is really nice to have.
Again, that was so sweet, ma'am. So coming to Dr. Radha, so what do you like to add in it?
Yeah, it's my confidence came more from innocence and not actually thinking too much into the future. Because those were times when if I thought, I couldn't have done it because of the circumstances, that there was a joint family and then there was a lot of load. And the terms were that you have to prioritize everything else that the family needs. And then if you have spare time, then you can. But then it was just that I lived by the day and went ahead without thinking too much. And I think that's true even today. If you start looking left and right and then think, then there's so many doubts that creep up, and they sometimes can be inhibitory unless you're looking at only the positive points. So don't think too much. If you're passionate, just live by the day and move ahead. And sure, even if it is baby steps, you'll reach your goal.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am. So then coming to Dr. Anuradha.
Yeah, I agree with Dr. Radha that when you have a dream and when you're stubborn enough to follow through with your dream, you don't think too much whether you can achieve, whether you can balance. Things sort of fall in place because you're determined that they will fall in place. So it's just your determination that you, that no matter what comes in your way, you're going to go ahead. It, as Dr. Radha said, it can be baby steps. Some days are very difficult. You feel you're not moving forward, but that's okay. Just stay there because the next day you will move forward. So it's just one day at a time, and things do move ahead. And as you start going, I mean, as life progresses, I think your family also, I mean, initially husband, but later children also, they appreciate your efforts. They understand what, how much of effort you're putting into doing what you're doing, and that makes them feel proud. And I think working women are big examples for their children. So the, especially boys, they learn to respect women and they learn to appreciate what women actually go through. So I think that's important.
That was wonderful, ma'am. Now we are going to YouTube question. I guess it is a very straightforward question. So what is the best job for women? So this question was asked by Rachita. So we'll start with Megha.
I think there's no best job for women. It's the best job for yourself. Okay, so what you want to do in and what's your strength and weakness, that's the profession you should go for. There is nothing best for women and best for men. Okay, you can be a good lawyer, you can be an athlete, you can be a tennis player, you can be an artist, but it really depends on what you enjoy doing. I think that's the key. You should follow what you really enjoy doing. And then you can be the Sachin Tendulkar of your field, right? That's what I think you should aim for.
For that, we are having a lot of examples here itself. We are having a very good Veena player. We are having an athlete who are doing a lot of good research. So, Dr. Anuradha, what is your add-on to that?
To what's the best job for a girl?
Yes.
Yeah, I agree with Megha. It's all, it all depends what you love doing, what's your dream, and what you're good at doing. That's where you should be. You should not. So I think the message to every girl is there is always, always in your life, there are two paths. So one is your path and one is what others choose for you. So you should have the courage to follow your path because that's where your strength is. Thank you. Yeah.
Next. Yes. Sorry. Yes, Megha.
Just saying that then I can't think of a profession which is bad for a girl, right? So how can there be something which is totally best and everything else is not good, right?
Yes.
Exactly.
I can't think of a profession like that.
So Dr. Radha, you want to add on anything?
Yeah, I think your profession should be your hobby. The times have changed. Maybe 30, 40 years ago, they would just say that if you're a woman, it's best if you do a teaching job in the school where your kids are going so that life is straightforward. And probably many people followed that path, but it's all about satisfaction. Or they used to say, why don't you choose a bank job? They were always recommending that something that doesn't involve too much of a challenge. Those times have changed. I think we just have to do what we like doing. Primarily, it, your profession or your job should be a hobby. Otherwise, you will just burn out very, very quickly. See, you're looking at a profession which is like, you know, you spend half your age in. See, until if you're 25 or 30, you're on a path of change. Like, you know, you move from school to college and then to some kind of higher education. There's always a change in scenario. The moment you join your job, half your life, like close to 30 years, you're spending in the same domain. So unless you like it very, very much, there's always this chance of burning up and disinterest, which will impinge on many other components of your life.
Yes, ma'am. So we can go to the next question. I'll start straight from Dr. Sonal. So if you are passionate of your career, but family does not support, in that situation, it's because basically because of gender bias. should we really drop our passion? This is a question from Raina.
No, actually, we should not. We should try to explain them, show them the examples. You know, there are so many women that are at really good positions. So you should actually discuss with your parents, your, you know, husband or, you know, whoever is in your family. And you show them examples that they can do it. You know, things are changing. You don't have to think that, you know, you're a girl, you can't do this. I mean, girls are doing every possible thing now. So you should sit and talk to them. And actually, if that doesn't work, then you can actually contact these women. You know, they will, I'm sure they will come in your support.
I guess to Raina, that is a very good advice for you. You can always contact these people for your support. And the next question is, how should women motivate themselves to pursue passion? So basically, you can tell your example, what qualities and helped you to be there in that motivation phase. So I can start with Dr. Anuradha. Sorry, no. Sonal, you can start.
That's okay. So yeah, here Sonal, I would go say, ahead. Yeah. So yeah. I don't think that I have a particular girl has a quality. I think everybody has all these qualities. It's up to them to decide, as we have already spoken. Second thing, for sure, they need support from family, and they need more than that, they need support from the workplace. So in most of the cases, what happens, they think about it and they go for it, but then they are demotivated either at their workplaces or, you know, by their friends. So that is something that we actually need to change, and not we, you young generation, especially boys, should think about and change. So I don't think there is a special quality in, like, you know, specific quality in me or Meghna or Radha or Anuradha. We all have it. We just need some support. Some people fight for it. Some people just drop. So they should really think about it.
I'll personally take that advice for myself. And Dr. Anuradha, you have any add-ons for that?
Yeah, I think Sonal has done it beautifully. So it's very true that many of the professions, we need a support system in the office, because women are capable, but then there is a glass ceiling. And sometimes the glass ceiling is toughened glass. It's not easy to break. And unless we have a support system, by support, I mean, it should not be patronizing. We do not need help like that, but there should be a frank and open approval or discussion about our work. And you know, the way men have their comradeship and their groups, and they support each other in a similar fashion, we should also have a group. Which, I mean, I'm not saying that we should band together or do something like that, but there should be people who support you in the system, who are going to encourage you, and when days are difficult, they help you to reach where you want to go. So that's important.
Dr. Megha?
Yeah. So like what Sonal and Anuradha said, that everybody has that quality. I think personally what I do is do a little bit every day. You have to keep at it. I think that's the key for me that works. That you have to keep at it, keep working towards it, and not be afraid to take any risk and challenges. That is something that you have to deal with. And it is a tough task to balance multiple things, that's given. So try not to think about and overthink about it every day that, oh, I have to do a perfect balancing act. That does not have to happen, you know. Yes. There are days when you can tip over to one side, and that's fine. So I think that works for me personally.
Absolutely. Yes. There are days when we can run, and then there are days when we just crawl. But it's okay. The point is, move forward.
Yeah. That was very good, ma'am. So I would like to ask this question to Radha, ma'am. So what change would you like to see in the world regarding women? So I would like to modify this question. So what was the change that you have seen throughout your 40 years of career, and what change that you want to see further?
Yeah, maybe the way the question was initially phrased, I will just say that there's nothing from the women's side that has to change. Okay, so each one of us don't need to particularly change. It's just about, if at all anything, the societal changes have to come in for better acceptance and recognition that women are also achievers, and women can also manage and multitask and be, meet both ends of the profession as well as personal lives. See, primarily, I think we should debate that biologically we are made differently and our tasks are different from that of men. As long as we don't compete in that front and accept that there are certain tasks that only we have to do, I think other things will fall into place. If you have people around you who are raising questions, I think these questions come because of a traditional system that is inherent in ages, that there are certain things that only a woman can do, and that will cause, because of that, taking on additional tasks might be more difficult for women. Okay, but those times are different. You never had the electronic gadgets in those days that we have today, which has made many, many household tasks easier. So earlier, you could spend a whole day, you know, doing actually the manual work that was required in a house. But today, we don't need to do that. So you have the time. So the change is not necessarily coming from women. Change has to come from the society and the families you are in, who will accept that both ends can be met.
So what
do
is
I answer, Kaushik? Do I answer
yes,
that?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes. That was very precise. What is your input regarding this question, Dr. Anuradha?
Yeah. So, yes, the changes. I think it's also a mental change. We have to. I don't think girls nowadays have that problem. But earlier, girls were born and brought up thinking that they are not capable of certain things. And it was put into their head that they always need some support, some, it's like a crutch, but that impression is gone now. We don't need crutches. We can walk on our own, and things are much better now. The opportunities are wider, the taboos are lesser, and I think even the men are changing. They're very supportive. Boys, I mean, I have two sons who are in their teens, late teens, and they're very supportive of their girl classmates. And there is absolutely no problems there. The only thing, the new problems which I see in girls nowadays is the social media. And it's more of a physical identity, you know, body shaming or wanting, craving for approval all the time on the social media. So that is something which is coming up new in the new generations. And I think girls have to deal with that and get over that also quickly. But other than that, I think the boys are also changing and they are pretty okay with girls doing anything and everything. Thank you.
Now we are having a person who needs to ask question. So Harshita from MS Teams, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Ma'am, my doubt is, it's like I'm sure what I want to do in my life. I want to pursue my career in field of research, but the only thing is I lack confidence. It's like even though I know certain things, I hesitate to speak my mind out in front of people. So what do I do in that regard?
Yeah, so Harshita, you have already opened up and spoken to us. So that's a first step, and I think that's a brave step. And as I told you, girls have no limitations nowadays, and you can do whatever you want. You just need that confidence and belief in yourself that you can achieve everything. You just have to go slow, go confident, and do what you like doing.
So Dr. Megha, you want to address about it?
If you're hesitant to converse and tell your thoughts, I think the first thing you should do is try to do this with your friends and family. And try to get into the habit of doing this. And then it will help you to, you know, do interviews or get into the next step of your academic career. Your friends and family will give you feedback which you should value, right? So if you feel that you're not able to voice your thoughts, I think that's a good starting point. To catch your friends, to catch your family members, and then try to converse with them and build your confidence as, yes, you have a piece of opinion that you can put forward to another set of people.
I guess it is a very good advice, point of advice that you can take. So now we are having a question, very interesting question. Do you think that following your passion is enough? Is an advice that comes from a place of a privilege compared to other women in the country? So this is from Nandita. So I guess Dr. Sonal can address this question.
Yeah, so it's not just enough to have this passion. You have to act on that, right? So if you don't have resources, then you have to try and find out how can you go about it. There are many, many institutes or many places. If you're talking about studies and, you know, learning these things, then you can actually contact people. There are many programs running where different NGOs are also there. They can help you with these things. So if most of the exams these days, they are competitive exams. So you don't have to go to a fancy school or a good college, you know. You can prepare and appear for those, and then it comes on the merit basis. So if you have a passion, you want to do something, it's not just enough. You have to work towards it. You have to put yourself, you know, to achieve that thing. So you have to study. You have to, if you want to go into painting, you have to start learning or try following that. So not just passion. You have to work with your full heart for that. And as I said, there are many, many places. People are getting good support. So I don't think it matters what family background you have or you, which college you go to or which school you go to. You have passion, you apply for these things, or you work towards it, people will see it. So if I have to take a student, I don't go by the college or school name. You know, I go by how the person is. So this is how, you know, you have to think.
Yes, I guess the question is like, maybe following your passion is very, that advice that we are, most of the women give, like hears, following your passion is enough. Is okay for the persons who can really follow, who can have their, who can really follow their passion, who can see their way. But I guess this question is for the women who are in underprivileged areas in the country. I guess that will be better if you can address that.
So, see, the thing is underprivileged. So, you mean they don't have resources, those sort of things, right?
Might be,
so,
yes.
For that, again, there are, yeah. So, there are NGOs. You know, they actually approach these people. So, you have to get in touch with those NGOs. And there are many. So, you get in touch with those people. They help you. Because I understand you don't have internet or you don't have, you know, computer. But you can actually still follow if you get in touch with these people. And then you come up with them. So that is what we can actually do right now.
Yeah. Any other want to add any point for this? Dr. Radha, you want to?
I understand exactly what is being asked and what is said. And what a person from such a circumstance must be facing. Certainly, there are differences in opportunities, especially in a country like ours, where circumstances, whether it's monetary circumstances or any other resource circumstances, may not be available. But this differential is becoming less and less, because what you have at your fingertips is an internet where you can explore information. And also, there are more and more opportunities of financial help by way of fellowships, which will allow you to take or which will allow you to take on the task of your interest. It is a reality that yes, there people from underprivileged circumstances may not have the same opportunity to fulfill their passions as those probably in an urban setting or people who belong to a class where they don't have to think of money.
Yes, I guess you have answered it perfectly. But now we are having a very important question. Why should the ones be on women to fight harder all the time? So I guess Anuradha, you can answer for this.
Unfortunately, that's true. The onus is more on us because, right, that's the way society has evolved for several years, several hundreds of years. And there have been different set of duties or responsibilities which have been assigned to men and women. And now we want to do everything. We want to have a family. We want to have a job. We want to be good in our career, as good as the as men. Whereas men still have only one set of responsibility. They are, I mean, it's not like there's an equal sharing of work. But as I told you, that's changing. And that's changing fast. Boys are also taking their share of responsibilities at home. Till now, the struggle was for women to balance everything. We have to do well at home and we have to do whatever we were doing earlier. And at the same time, we have to excel in our career and we have to excel in an area which is male dominated. For example, I work in wildlife research. I mean, both science and wildlife are both are male dominated areas. So it becomes doubly difficult for us to be heard, for people to actually acknowledge that, okay, this person is intelligent or this person is talking something worthwhile. Whether it's man or woman, it does not matter. So you have to break those barriers and reach a point. So that becomes doubly difficult for a girl. Yes. Onus is always on the girl. Yes.
So actually, that is the hurtful fact that we are going on. Yes. Dr. Megha, you want to add some point to that?
But Kaushik, at the same time, because of this onus, I think we also become stronger. We learn to deal with everything and that makes us stronger people. So we don't give in that easily. No matter what the disappointment, we know how to tackle it after a certain point. Earlier, of course, the disappointments are heavy and we feel we might give up. But once we learn to tackle these problems, we become stronger day by day. And we are not going to give up that easily. Yeah.
Actually, that is the positive point that all the women should see, I guess. Dr. Megha, you want to add on anything into it?
I think Dr. Anuradha just said what I wanted to say, that don't take it as a negative and a burden. But instead, take it as a positive and take it as a challenge that you can do it. And if you keep at it in that manner, then it will be much easier emotionally and professionally for you to go to the next step. These things exist, you accept it and then move towards breaking it slowly. Right?
And that's why I've made the third point, Kaushik, that we should have a support system of women around us. You see, every other social animal in this world, elephants or any other social species you look at, they have a group of women, I mean females, helping them, helping each other. So that is extremely important. That it may be very few, it may be just one or two women in your life, but these women are very important. It could be your mother, sister, friend, colleague. But it should be a person who understands you perfectly and who is your support system no matter what time of the day or night it is. So when you have such people in your life, and believe me, only a woman can understand a woman. So no matter what equations we have with men, end of the day, I think it's more comforting when you can talk freely to another woman. And that type of a network you should have in your life. And it makes life very easy. I mean, not very easy, but at least bearable. So many problems just slide away, because you, when you discuss it with other women, you realize that you're not alone. Everybody has gone through these problems and everybody has managed to tackle these problems in their own way. So the problem then stops being that big. Otherwise, you just sit alone and think, oh my God, this thing is so big and I don't know how to deal with it and it's all happening just with me. No, it's not happening with you. It's happening with everybody. So when you have this small group of friends, especially women, then we learn how to deal with our problems. In the rural society or even semi-urban societies, you see that women have their friends and their groups. But as an urban woman, as a professional woman, we lose that. And we become very alone in life. That's not right. And psychologically, I think that is the support we need.
I guess every...
Want to say something here.
Yes.
So it's not just that. Girls should stand up for themselves. They should make the male guys, like, you know, their colleagues or friends, they should make them understand what we are going through. We are biologists, or if not biologists, any field, they all know, they all have family, women in their family. They can understand each and everything. It's not that there is, I need, you know, to talk to somebody. They should make their friends who are boys or, you know, colleagues, they should make them understand that this is how it is. They should stand up and tell. There is no shame in saying anything that, you know, happens, basically. So we are all human beings. You have women in family. There should be no shame in saying that. And I don't think it should be just, you know, a circle of women. It can be guys. So they should stand up for themselves. And they should make these guys understand that this is how it is. This I like. This I don't like. This is how you should behave. You know.
So what I was trying to say is, yes, you should stand up for your rights. And all of us face it all the time. We face comments, we face jokes which men crack on us. We face it all the time, right? And then you reach a point where you decide whether you want to fight back or you let it just pass because it's not important. Okay, it's not worth bothering your head about. So and many times, I think there are several inhibitions which girls have. They can't discuss things easily. But if you have a strong network, then that gives you the courage to talk out also. So yes, when there is misconduct against you, when there are problems against you, you should speak up. And I think friends give you the courage to speak up.
I guess the point is we should have a support system, we should have a support system. Yes, I completely agree with the point. Then we are having a question, like a person who is from MS Teams called as Stuti. She wants to ask some question. So Stuti, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. Stuti,
thank you. Yes. So I have a question. Yes, yeah. Thank you. So my question is based on a study by the USI, which was done in 2019 and showed that 40% of science graduates from India are female. However, only 14% of researchers are actually female in India. So how do you think we can battle this leaky pipeline on a national and grassroots level?
Yes, Sonal should answer it. Yes.
So exactly, the UIS says that 30% overall, not just India, you know, in the whole world, only 30% people, women are in science. And when we start, as I gave an example, we start with 40 and we are like one or zero sometimes end up being a faculty. So it's not just in India, it's everywhere. But the majorly the reason is that the support system that we or the colleagues, you know, or the male people who are working around, not just male, actually women scientists, women people also who are working around. So the women seniors, sometimes we have this feeling that we have gone through this, so you have to go through this. Or the man thinks, how can she is doing it? Why can't, you know, how can she do what I'm doing? So we have this problem. And the girl student who thinks that I want to be a postdoc, then I want to become a faculty, then she has, you know, slowly she develops, you know, maybe it's not for me, or, you know, I don't think I can do it because, you know, I will have this problem. So they need to stand up. In India, we have this problem. Of course, it comes from family that they don't learn. In majority of cases, they don't learn how to fight back, how to, you know, defend, how to take challenges. But right now, it's changing. I mean, I can give you example from here that, you know, apart from, you know, in the whole world, I don't know how it is going, but it's changing. If you think about CCMB as a system right now, we are like out of 10 recruits, we are like 40% are women, which is little more than, you know, what happened in last 20 years, basically. So it depends on the girl also, but it also depends on the surrounding system. Again, it comes back to support and the girl who should stand up and fight back. That we don't see in majority of cases. So yes, we need to educate people, not just juniors, seniors also, that they should actually support girls and so that they can progress.
Yes. Dr. Radha, you wanted to add something into it?
I think this issue is being recognized not only in India, but across various countries. And special opportunities are being provided because of the biological requirements or biological needs that a woman has to fulfill at a certain time in her age. And that time usually falls at the end of her education before her career is taken up. So when governments enable that a woman can take a break, and taking a break is not looked down upon, I think everything becomes possible. And a woman should not also feel guilty if she has to take a break, whether it's in the education or in the career, because that's also as fulfilling as a career for a woman and very, very important in the context of a family. So I think these things are changing, and once our government comes up with more and more schemes, I think the next 10 years things will change for the better.
I guess the person who asked about the underprivileged society wants to know more about it, and I guess the person wants to know other possibilities to succeed, I guess. So the question is, like, how many faculty students do you know in top institutes who have came via the help of NGO? And underprivileged area people are very, very, very less in top institutes. So I guess, Megha, you can address this question.
I don't have the stats for how many underprivileged women have been recruited as faculty or as in higher academic institutions, but I think women in general, it is quite less for all the institutes, for most disciplines, especially the science, technology, engineering and medicine. And I think the underprivileged section becomes even worse hit when you look at the total women thing. But I think the key would be to encourage women at a career stage when they finished education but not begun a professional training period like a postdoc, is when we need to encourage these women to stay in focus while they have a family. If they have a break, then try to come back as quick as possible as they can. Or even if they don't take a break, try to tide over both things. It will be difficult to manage, but that's the key. I think that's where we need to push women through so that they reach the next stage of their academic careers for getting recruited as a faculty or as another professional career option in, say, other research institutes or universities.
Dr. Sonal, you can actually add upon a very important point into this, because the question about NGOs, you put forth it, so you can, the person needs more possibilities, I get. So can you address about it?
Okay, so she can write me also later on, but I know what is happening in Telangana. There are a couple of NGOs that are working. There is the Telangana NGO Alliance. So actually, if she's from here, then she can actually write to them. If she cannot write to them, she can post a letter to them. And then there are people who actually go and support. The people go for these rural different places who support to, you know, like they run study programs. So she can approach them or she can write to me. No problem. I can support. I can tell her a couple of NGOs that actually are working in these fields. And then she can basically go according to them. So if she's in school, I don't know whether she's in school or she's in college. But yes, for the school children, there are these NGOs. They're actually working for to bring especially the girl child education thing.
I guess as Dr. Sonal told that the change is here and the time needs to answer those questions. And I guess these NGOs are very functional and we are already seeing the outputs of those. And going into the next question, institute outreach is often limited to cities. How can we reach girls, women in rural areas and at least make them feel that there are many paths that they can take with our limited resource? This question is from YouTube and this question was asked by Ashish. So I guess Anuradha Reddy, so you can answer it.
Yeah, so I agree that there are a lot of limitations here. And although we take some of our privileges for granted and we don't understand the extent or struggle of girls in underprivileged societies. So, and especially outreach to rural areas, I think CCMB does programs where we try to reach out to students and schools, government schools or less schools. But there are changes which are already in place. There are NGOs and there are a lot of schemes which the government has started to bring girls into schools. But I think it's the society, it's the family, and it's the mental makeup which has to change. And it is changing slowly. So once girls, anyway, whether it's rural or urban, the present economic condition is that everybody has to work, right? We can't afford not to work. So anyways, you have to study, you have to do something in your life. So it's better you do something you like doing. It will also give you satisfaction as well as you might excel in whatever you're doing. So I think that's the key because, but it is difficult. It is definitely difficult for the underprivileged and the rural societies. We as a country and we as people who are capable or who have abilities, I think we have to support these people and try to build up a better platform for them.
Yes. So we are having Stuti with another question. So Stuti, you can unmute yourself and you can ask your question.
Yeah, my question was, how do you think men can be better allies to women in science?
So, Dr. Megha, you would like to address the question?
Yes, I think for one, treat men and women in the same page and plane. Don't look at your colleague as a male or a female. I think that's where you need to begin. In terms of discussing science and discussing collaborations, in discussing policy making regarding your institute, I think that's what you need to first look at is what the opinion is, not regard the gender of the person, right? I think that's what we really need to value to begin with.
So Dr. Radha, you would like to add any valid points into it?
Yeah, I don't think it is that much of an issue as long as there is a capability and value to the points or thoughts coming up from a woman versus a man. It's more about what is feasible and just don't make comparisons. Just don't have a prejudice to start with. And then I think things will fall into place.
So we are having another question. Do we need policies that enable men and other gender identities also to take a break to raise a family? This might encourage the idea that family is not just a women's primary responsibility. This question was asked by Annapurna. So I guess, Sonal, you can take this question.
So actually, there is one. If a dad wants to stay home and take care of the baby, he can take paternal, you know, it's like maternity leave. They have paternity leave. So it depends. It's not that we have to, you know, make a policy. The policy is already there. It's up to the man. So in many cases, people actually do that. Half time, woman takes off and takes care of the baby. And then half time, man takes off and takes care of the baby. So actually, I see here examples here in my institute where actually dad is taking care of the kid and mom is trying to finish her research and, you know, wrap up things. It same happened in my case. So it was my husband who took care of my kid while I was actually researching and finishing my postdoc. So it's not that we need that policy. We need that, you know, we need to accept it. So the guys need to think and accept that it is fine to sit at home and take care of the baby. The policies are there.
I guess that mentality should be there in everyone's mind. But Sonal, do you think if you see the leave that is allotted for paternal and maternal thing, maternal case, in for father it is only 2 weeks, but in the case of mother it is 6 months. But how do you see this? Since you yes, please.
So that's for mother it is 6 months. So this is in Indian case. In India it is like that. So for sure it depends on how you know it went. For mother she needs to recover. Most of the times they undergo a major operation, so they need to recover. So they need 1 to 2 months off. They need to constantly feed the baby. We don't have a system here. I don't know. I rarely see, you know, where, you know, people say that, oh, there is a nursing room in an institute where a woman can go and pump milk for their babies. So, of course, we need to think about those things. So that should be there. Then women, you know, feel that, yeah, okay, we have to, we have the support so we can come back to work. For dad, he doesn't need to go back and feed the baby 4 times. So this is why we have these, you know, differences. But otherwise, in other countries, if you see, there are, you know, it can be mom or dad where there is a good support. So we really need to think about this thing. For every institute, we need to think about. There should be daycare facility, right? Mom can bring the kid and keep in the daycare. And then she can work and go visit kid whenever there is little time. So that is one thing which every institute in India should actually bring, because we lack that system, and like we don't have that system in many institutes. So basically, these are the points that I would say that, you know, will help a woman come back. And this is the time, you know, the difference, because it's our mentality that woman has to go and take care of the baby. We need to change that.
Can I add to this?
Yes,
ma'am. I'm a comparatively new mother. And what I would say is that even if you don't have all these facilities of a nursing room and, you know, you going back multiple times, all those things, even if you have to take care of the baby for the 6 months, you have life beyond 6 months to recuperate, to catch up, to do all these things, right? So then after the 6 months of, you know, you being a primary caregiver, or after even a year of being a primary caregiver, you can come back with more vigor, okay? And it's not like you've lost the battle completely and all hell break loose and you can never recover back. That's not the case, right? So after 6 months, a year, you can slowly crank up back to being what you need to do. And trust me, the 6 months is not the most important 6 months of your career that you have lost out and that will never come back. That's not the case, you know. You might be a few years behind your other colleagues, maybe, if those 6 months impacted so much. But I think you can catch up on those 6 months or a year's time that you have kind of given more towards family. So I think it's a little trade-off. You might be a little slow, but it's not that you can't catch up.
I guess, Dr. Radha, you should say something, some points about it, because we have heard that you finished your PhD so early in, to take care of your children. So this will be you will be the best person. Can you please?
I did my PhD or joined a career when none of these facilities were available, like what is being talked about today, a crash, or, you know, even the whole concept of mother pumping milk or something like that. It was sort of, you know, such a taboo thing to even think of. But times have changed. But today, take it that the government of India is very supportive if you are in India, or I think all other governments. And it is a must. It's mandatory for institutes with a certain number of women employees to have a creche facility. So it's not that it's impossible, because family support, I know, is dwindling. Probably earlier time when there were joint families, it was much easier to raise kids while the mother was at work. But today with, you know, unit families where just the two parents have to, you know, juggle with one or two children, it's becoming a major task and which actually weighs down. But one thing I would say is that children just grow up and that time will pass. Okay, so it's just about having the conviction that both are possible. So as a particular note to women, whether your career is in science or not in science, actually, I would say a career in science is sometimes even more easier because you are at a thinking job, though there will be physical constraints. Okay, and you can do your thinking wherever you are, as long as the organization allows you a little flexibility. But the other thing is that make sure that you don't lose out on or don't postpone your personal priorities just because in your career. One thing I know from my experience is every woman who has thought a profession will be compromised if they make any particular personal choices that will be demanding, like having children or living in a joint family, have regretted when they have been much older. Delaying, because your age will not wait. So that is something that is very important. It's okay to take a break. Like Megha mentioned, it all depends on the intellect you have and your abilities to catch up in a race. There's nothing like forward and backward. And you're much happier if you don't make any comparisons. It's not about comparisons with men. Forget making any comparison. The moment you start comparing, you will always have somebody who has something more than you, somebody who has something less than you. And that becomes a point of negative thought. So I think focusing on the point at hand, and I will also, as a last point, mention that women do have the capability of multitasking. I think nature has made us in many ways mentally as well as reasonably physically stronger to take care of multiple activities, which includes not only taking care of our family, but also we have managed pretty, pretty successfully with taking care of a profession.
Actually, we can see that.
I would like to add here to what Megha said. So, yes, it's not a race, and we do not lose out by backing off a little, because after all, we have gained by having children. So it's not a trade-off. We don't. It's not that just because we have had children, we have lost out in science or in our career. And so I took a break. I had my children and so could not do my PhD. Of course, I had my job, but I could not do my PhD. And so that was perfectly okay. And also at the same time, when my children were young, I had to go to the forest. I had to do a lot of trips. So it was thanks to my husband. And so one of my sons would stay with my husband and one would come with me to the forest. And so we juggled it that way. And I don't think it's a loss. In many ways, it's good to spend some time building your bonds with your family. And you can always catch up with your career later on. It's how much confidence you have in yourself. How far do you want to go in life? That's what is important. And you will catch up in the end. Nobody is going anywhere.
Actually, I can see the confidence from your experience speaking. Stuti is here with another question. Stuti, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I have another question. But my question was, as a non-academic and a non-research society, how can we tackle the Matilda effect?
Sorry, can you repeat your question?
Yes, so my question was, as a non-academic and a non-research society, how can we tackle the Matilda effect? So the Matilda effect is essentially a bias against acknowledging the achievement of female scientists.
That's a very wonderful question. So I guess, Megha, you can address the question.
You're talking about non-academic, non-scientific career options, right? That's what you would want to ask?
Yes.
Okay. So that would be a little tough cookie for me because I'm not an expert on non-scientific or non-academic. But I
don't see, let me answer that. I don't think one has to actually differentiate between what is non-scientific as far as you are thinking of a woman in a profession. So if you're asking about, you know, whether their challenges are different if you're in a science or in an academic profession versus some other profession, I think every profession is a challenge.
Right, and every profession would have similar challenges that we have, right? The family challenge does not change between professions, right? Or juggling between your career and looking at everything else does not change between professions.
Dr. Sonal, you want to add up some point?
Yeah, so Matilda effect. So I would say we cannot change the generation, but actually what we can do to change is train new generation. We have different programs for young people so that they understand that they should not take it to ego that a woman could do this thing and the boy couldn't do it. We have to train this new generation in a way that they understand this. Okay, it is equal, 50-50. We have seen this Matilda effect many times in past, you know, where we actually, when we learned, when we checked textbook, we didn't even know that, oh, this woman was there. She contributed. Maybe she did the job. So whatever happened, we can't change. But the new generation, we can actually have workshops. We can have programs for them so that they realize this thing. And we give them examples so that they feel this is not fair. Whatever happened was not fair. So when you start giving these examples and they put in their mind that this is not fair, then they realize and then they appreciate their, you know, female colleagues' work or, you know, friends' work. So they will appreciate and they will start praising them or, you know, working towards helping them. Whatever happened, yes. Happened, but we can do that with the new generation, with young people, yeah, especially PhD programs.
The
right?
Changes
so we
already
have to do that
happened.
Actually.
Yeah, Dr.
So this is what I think we should be doing.
Yeah, as I told earlier, the change is already happening. Young boys acknowledge now that their girl classmates or friends are equal to them, and they do not have all these perceptions about girls not being capable of achieving anything. So the changes are already visible, at least in urban societies, they're visible. I think it has to spread out a little more and become stronger. And girls also have to prove that they are. I mean, I think it's already there in place. It's not such a big issue now anymore.
So I guess that answers your question. But Stuti, since we are already past our time, you can write to people you want to, or you can write to us. Our mail ID is there in our Open Week website, so you can go and see that, and you can write to us, and we'll try to answer your question. So since we are almost at the end of our discussion, so I would like to hear some brief final thoughts from this panel discussion from each of you. I guess I can start from Dr. Radha.
Yeah, I see, and the anxieties in girls who are at a cusp and trying to make a choice particularly if they are thinking of a career in science. Maybe it's a mindset that doing science is very, very difficult, and you know, it will hamper a lot of your personal life. But let me tell you, science is something that you do as a 24-hour job. It's not limited to working hours like in a bank or something that you do in an accountancy. It's because it's a thinking job, you carry your work home. So there are some difficulties when you have a thinking job, and you have to, that's where you have to compartmentalize your thoughts and try to channelize. If you're physically not at home, worrying about what is happening at home is not going to help you. So try to channelize. When you're at work, try to blind yourself to what you have left behind at home. When you're at home, shut out all the anxieties from your office, what your seniors have said, or somebody you're working with, all those anxieties. That's one way to tide over and balance and achieve both ends.
I guess that point should be is valid for all the persons. Then Dr. Sonal.
Yeah, I would say girls need to stand up for their, you know, what they think. They should learn how to say no. If you don't want something, if you think something is not going right, say. If you have contributed something, you are not getting credit, say that you did it. And then at the end, of course, there are problems at every step, but doesn't mean that you have to think, okay, there is no other option, I should sit back. As Radha said, you have to fight continuously. You have to follow your passion. You have to put yourself completely. If you are married, talk to your spouse that you want to do it, and you will do it. And work out how can you do it. If it is your supervisor or your colleague at your workplace, tell them this is the limit. You need to stop here. This is my area. Let me do it. So you need to speak up for yourself, and you need to learn. If you have contributed, say it. And then you cannot take everything from everybody. No matter it is your supervisor, if it is your teacher, or if it is your friend, or maybe it's your colleague. You need to really fight for yourself, and then keep following what your passion is basically. So at any point, you should think that if somebody can do it, if Marie Curie could do it, I can do it too. So think like that. You can do it.
That was very inspirational. Dr. Megha?
Yeah, I think take every day little steps towards your goals. Always have your goals in mind. Take little steps every single day. And you have to believe in yourself. If you don't believe in yourself, nobody is going to believe in you. Okay? You have to keep the faith inside you as much as hostility in the outside can be. But if you have belief in yourself that I can do it, be it however complex, whatever juggling it takes, whatever X amount of, you know, negotiation or haggling with somebody or whatever it takes, but you have to believe that you can do it. And then I haven't finished my journey to actually say that I've done everything that I believe in, but I think I can get to it. Okay, so at least it looks achievable at this point.
Believing in yourself is actually an advice that anyone can take. And Dr. Anuradha Reddy, your views about the panel discussion?
Yeah, just my last thing. I love dreamers, and I encourage people to dream big, and passionately believe in yourself. Do not lose focus on your path, and do not follow what others choose for you. You have to believe in yourself and allow yourself, give yourself the freedom to dream. I think everything is achievable.
Kaushik, so, I would like to add one point.
Yes.
And that is, never feel guilty about anything. When you are at work, don't feel guilty that you have left something behind at home. When you are at home, don't feel guilty that you are not fulfilling your task at work. So everything will fall into place as long as you are at it and living by the day. Okay, just plan, manage your time very well, and don't ever think that these profession and personal life are mutually exclusive.
That was a very wonderful wonderful point, ma'am. So balancing the professional and personal life is almost important to everyone, whether it's men or women, we are in a situation that, as Sonal told, that both have to work. And yes, so now we are in the end of our panel discussion. Actually, we thought it will go for 1 hour, but we actually crossed 1 hour 20 minutes, and it was a very good experience for me at least, and I'm very sure that all the others who are hearing it is also could have got the same vibe as me. So now we are at the end of our panel discussion. I'm very sure that the talk was very inspiring, and I hope this session would be useful for young women who are a science enthusiast. I would say that it is not only for science enthusiasts, but for the all who wants to achieve. And I would like to end up this session with Marie Curie's famous words: "Be less curious about people and more curious about ideas." This is nothing but Radha now have explained this on her own words, and that was very thought provoking. Thank you all for being in this discussion for this much time. And please do fill the feedback form, which is there in the YouTube chat box, and which is there in the MS Team link, MS Team chat box also. That will help us to improve. And thank you for your patience. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.